Hey everyone, this is Lynn Bartim, and you are listening to the Apex Hour on KSUU Thunder 91.1. In this show, you get more personal time with the guests who visit Southern Utah University from all over, learning more about their stories and opinions beyond their presentations on stage. We will also give you some new music to listen to and hope to turn you on to some new sounds and new genres. You can find us here every Thursday at 3 p.m. or on the web at seu.edu/apex. But for now, welcome to this week's show here on Thunder 91.1. Okay, welcome to this week's show. This is Lynn Bartan, and this week is all about comedy here at SUU. We had a great event this morning here in this blustery day here in January on campus, and we had our own talent here from Cedar City. With Apex events, so often we have people come from away, and we celebrate all the people from around the nation and around the world, but today we get to celebrate Cedar City. And we were celebrating it with Off the Cuff, our local improvisation comedy group. And I have one of its members, maybe two later on in the hour.
Yeah, quite possibly.
I hope so. Well, we hope we have one and maybe two, and who knows who will show up. But we're going to be talking about Off the Cuff and its history and who it is and what they do and get into some discussions. So, Rev, tell us about the group and yourself.
Well, we just celebrated our 15-year anniversary this past weekend.
So cool. That's so cool. I can't wait to ask you more about that.
Yeah, it was a lot of fun. I have been with the group since 2005, so about 14 of the 15 years. So.
And how did you first get involved with them?
Well, when I was in junior high school and high school, I was interested in improv, and I started doing actual improv while I was in high school. I lucked out and got onto our high school team, and it became one of my favorite things to do, and was also part of my theater career as well. So when I came to school, my goal was to find something to do in the realm of improv as well. And luckily, my friend Clint, who had come down here to go to school as well, he had told me about this group that was just forming called Off the Cuff, and that he had played with them a few times. And so I knew that when I came down here, I was going to seek those guys out and try to be involved in some way. And so
now, when you said you got involved in high school, was that that was here, or no, you grew up somewhere else?
Salt Lake. Murray.
Okay.
Specifically.
Murray, yeah.
Yeah, I went to Murray High School.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
And then did you come to school here?
Mm-hmm.
So yeah. There's a big SUU connection, Southern Utah University, Off the Cuff. There's a big link there.
Yeah, really, everybody in Off the Cuff right now, except for one of our members, Nate, are alumni of SUU.
That's amazing. I mean, what an incredible feather in our cap, and how fun to celebrate that connection and have you guys back on campus.
Yeah, Off the Cuff technically started while the founders were still in school at
right.
SUU, as a way for them to have more opportunities to perform improv. And they started out by just wanting to do it for like a semester. You know, they were pretty, they didn't have any expectations about it. They were just like, yeah, what if we did a show for fun and see what happens? And then 15 years later, it's still going. So.
Yeah, and so now the group consists, tell me a little bit about the makeup. The group consists of how many players?
So we have a core management team, which is myself, Wendy, and TJ Penrod, who are two of the founding members, mm-hmm. Leah Wergler, and then Nate, who mm-hmm. I just mentioned, Nate Mackley, who might be joining us today if he doesn't think that the studio is still in the Centrum.
Maybe he's listening.
Yeah.
Nate, come to the student center.
That was my subtle way of hinting if he was listening to be like, hey, it's not there. And then beyond that, so Leah is our technical and sound person during the show, runs lights and sound. And then the rest of us are performers. Then we have a regular performer, Dave Armour, who is also one of the founders. He plays every Friday as well. Mm-hmm. And then we have a rotating cast of a number of different people who are guest players who we invite to play either with us in the show regularly or to fill in if somebody can't be there for the show. And that's why the 15-year anniversary was so cool, is because essentially we invite back everybody who's ever been asked to play with Off the Cuff over its 15 years, guest players, core members, management, all of that. And this year we got over about 50 people.
That's incredible.
Coming back to perform. So it's kind of like a family reunion.
That's awesome. Yeah. And tell me about the 15th anniversary. It was a two-day event? Is that how it worked?
Yeah. So when we did our 10-year anniversary, we realized that at that point we'd had so many people come through Off the Cuff that it was getting to the point that there was no way we could fit it on one. If we were to fit it onto one night, it would probably be like 5 hours long because we would have like 60 people on stage, and we're like, well, everybody's got to play once at
least. Exactly. That would be crazy. Can you imagine? Yeah. Everybody gets one sentence.
Yeah. Everybody gets to play one game and then sit there for 6 hours. No. But so we split that into two nights on our 10-year anniversary, and we realized that the 15-year was probably going to be the same situation.
Yeah.
Because obviously everybody that we've played with have lives now. A lot of them have families, lots of commitments. So many of them can't come to our yearly birthdays because we do have a birthday celebration every year.
Oh, you do?
Yeah, but the 10 and the 5s are the big ones, yeah, right, that everybody wants to come and support. So we knew that the 10 and the 15 are, and then the 20 in the future will be insane. And so, yeah, we split it over Friday and Saturday, 3 hour long shows each.
Wow. How do you structure? I mean, I want to ask you about the regular weekly shows, but while we're on the anniversary, how do you structure a show like that? I mean, do you sit around at a table and kind of say, okay, we know 20 games. We're going to do these three here. How does the planning work?
So for our birthday shows, Wendy Penrod is kind of the mastermind behind figuring out the numbers situation. So because up until the day of, we've got people who are like confirming or canceling, being like, hey, remember how I said like 3 months ago I was going to come to that show? Yeah, I'm not coming now. Sorry that it's tonight. And so we often, it has to be changing constantly, but Wendy's kind of been the one who's like just so great at it.
Yeah.
And so she plans out like what type of game is being played. And by that, I mean like how many players. So we identify games by 4-player games, 3-player games, 2-player games, all player games, that kind of thing.
I see.
And so she'll do the math to figure out, okay, so in the first half, we'll have a 4, a 2, a 3, a 3, a 3, a 2, a 4, right?
Wow.
And what we do, which is different than our regular shows, is that we'll put all of the games that we have in our repertoire into a cup, and then all of the names of the players into a cup, and we just pick it completely randomly.
Oh, completely random,
yeah,
for birthday
so
shows.
We'll just pick the 4 people who are going to be in the game. Some of them have probably maybe never even played with each other before. They just met that day. And then we'll just pick a game and be like, all right, cool. So now we're doing Oscar-winning moments, I guess. Sweet.
And is that more nerve-wracking or less nerve-wracking? I mean, it must be in a way easier if you don't know anything. It's kind of like whatever. But then again, you might end up with somebody that's harder to play off of.
Well, that's how we used funny, we used to run our show like that weekly, where we would just pick games randomly and pick who's playing the games randomly on a smaller scale, obviously.
Right.
So we've gotten to the point where we're not super worried about it during the regular show because we've got enough mixture of people who have played with us who then went on to continue doing improv in other places and other people who like stopped doing improv.
Mm.
So there's an average to good chance that we will at least have a couple of people in the games that are good at or still practice improv regularly. And so we have faith that they're able to help each other out to come through, essentially. Yeah. So it's a team activity.
And the team part of it is so like intriguing to me, how all the personalities meld and everything like that. I want to ask you about that too. But just briefly back to the birthday thing. So it was two nights, and as I understand it, it was completely sold out.
Yes, we had packed houses both nights. There was standing room only.
Oh my gosh, that's so great. And then have you already started planning for the 20 year?
Oh, geez.
it was only last week. So.
Yeah, I was like, well, let's plan for the 16th year first. Right. Let's take it one day at a time. But yeah, we it's definitely on our radar for sure.
Well, cool. I'd love to talk a little bit about the Friday show, because one of the things we really want to make sure to point out is to really promote that you guys are on every Friday.
Yeah, there are only a couple of times in the year that we don't have shows consistently, which is December. We'll usually take at least 2 weeks off for the Christmas holiday and the New Year.
Yeah.
Mostly just because we understand that nobody's here in town anyway.
Yeah, everybody's traveling.
And then we sometimes will take a week or two off in May during the like transition between spring
school and summer. Yeah.
Because it's usually our slowest time of year.
Interesting.
And that's a time that we'll do like renovations on our theater or repairs, maintenance, that kind of thing.
Yeah.
And it's just the break between the college crowd leaving and the festival crowd coming.
Right. So. Okay. It's interesting to me that would be, I'm always curious with different people's careers and jobs and organizations, when are hot times of the year and when are slow times. And I wouldn't have expected that, but it makes complete sense, particularly in Cedar City, because we do have that changeover between the academic population. And then we have a huge festival population coming in for our Shakespeare shows.
Yeah. Yeah. So our big time of the year is definitely during the school year.
Uh-huh.
The fall is usually our best time of the year, followed probably by the spring. And then our summer is usually the slowest season, because while we do have the festival crowd, let's just say some of them are aged to the point where a 10 p.m. show is a little bit late for them to come and hang out. I mean, I'm 33 years old and I'm to the point where I'm like, hey, guys, why do we still do this at 10 p.m.?
Let's start at 7. So tell me, the show starts at 10?
10 p.m., yeah. Doors usually open at 9:30 at our theater.
And the seating is first come, first serve?
Yes.
So people can come at 9:30 if they want to like really choose their spot.
Yeah, a lot of people like to come to the theater because they've, you know, identified the seat that they like to sit in. Or there's two types of seats. The ones that people like to sit in the most are the comfy theater style seats that are, you know, cushioned and like you find in a movie theater. And then there are some in the front, which a lot of people like to sit in as well because they're closer to the stage, which are just regular kinds of chairs.
And about how many do you seat?
On an average day, we can seat about 100 people in just our regular theater.
Oh, that many.
But for our birthday show and other big events, we have a temporary wall that we take down. So there's a wall that separates the audience from like the path to the bathroom.
Right.
So that nobody has to feel like super self-conscious about, hey, everybody, I'm going to the bathroom. You can see me. And instead, we take that wall down and we set up more chairs. And at that point, we can usually fit around 150 to 180.
No kidding.
200 if we really cram them in there.
I didn't know that it was that it sat that many. That's fantastic.
Yeah, we've played Tetris a lot to figure out the best format and way to get people in there. So, yeah.
Right. And the show costs $7?
$7,
right? Mm-hmm. That's a steal. That's less than a movie these days.
And we also, while you're at our show, we have what used to be called Tweet for Seats, but then we expanded it out to other social media. So for some reason, we started calling it Wendy's Social Media Extravaganza. And if she were here, she would hurry and run up to the microphone and shout that at us, but because she'll do it at the show. But where during the show, if you want, we encourage you to be on your social media on your phones, as long as it's on silent, and to like tweet or post funny quotes or things that you think you want to comment on or take pictures and then tag us in it. And then at the end of the show, we go through all of them, and then we reward people who gave us the best ones a free show next week.
Oh my gosh, what a great idea.
So if you don't want to pay $7 every single week, you should just come and tweet a bunch. And you'll probably get another free show.
That's so cool.
We've had people who have just, they were the only ones tweeting ever, so they... I don't think they paid for a show for like 2 months
because
they just kept winning over and over again.
That's a great idea. And then you just tag. I mean, it's just either a tag or a hashtag or whatever.
Yeah. So if it was Twitter or Instagram, you would just do the @ OTCCOMEDY. Because for some reason that shows up better than if we use hashtags. I don't know why. Hashtag OTC comedy doesn't show up as readily for us than as just the @ because that's actually tagging the account.
Okay.
And then on Facebook, it's just off-the-cuff comedy improvisation. It's the whole – it's a page that it would should come up if you're if you're already a fan of the page. If you're not a fan of the page, go to Facebook and off-the-cuff comedy improvisation in Cedar City. So there might be other off-the-cuffs that come up, but it's
Cedar
the only
City.
One that's in Cedar City. like the page, and then it'll pop up when you – type stuff. Yeah.
Oh, fantastic. And the website again is OTC comedy. So there are two C's there, right?
Yes, OTC comedy.com.
Perfect. And you can check all that out. Well, we're going to come back and talk about what improv actually is for anybody who's curious and may not have been to a show. But in the meantime, as always, I have a song for you. And this first song is called About You, and the band is called G-Flip. So this is the Apex Hour, KSUU Thunder 91.1.
Another part of me, hitting back, slap in the face. Yeah, you were the key. Yeah, I knew I'd see this other part of me, beating my chest, painting my breast. Yeah, you were the key. And you know that you were right. You know I hate to fight. You know I can't believe. You're right. Follow through and leave me on the rocks. Yeah, I still got no honey. I still got no honey. And we still acting funny. We still acting funny. Yeah, I could chase you. We'd be up all night like the old days. Yeah, we never had a fight. Still, I don't know. Maybe that just goes to show. I don't know if you're just gonna go. You're just gonna leave. And we're just living off pages. This book's for the ages. Roller coaster like we said on. You're right.
All right. Well, welcome back to the Apex Hour. We are growing in number here in the studio, KSUU Thunder 91.1. My name is Lynn Vartan, and we are talking all things improv comedy with two of the members now of Off the Cuff. We're going to welcome back Rev and say hi to Nate.
Hi. How's it going?
It's going great.
We've multiplied.
That's right.
Watch out, world.
We're like Tribbles.
Tribbles?
Is that, yeah, that's a thing. From Star Trek?
Rabbits or cockroaches.
Or gremlins?
I wasn't going to imply that there was any kind of mating happening. I was just going to say that we were multiplying.
I mean, you know, I'm not a scientist, so I don't know how they multiply.
What, tribbles?
Anything.
You don't know? Okay. Yep. How do you have three kids?
A mystery.
Okay.
Well, it's multiplying in a way.
I just woke up and they were there. Yeah,
exactly.
Well, now that I've got two of you, I could just probably let you riff for the rest of the hour.
And we'll get nothing done.
Yeah.
Well, we're here to talk in this break about what improv is. And I mean, I think everybody knows what improvisation is, but what is improv comedy to you? How do you define it when people ask you, like, hey, what about this thing that you do?
That's
kind of hard to define, but usually I give like an example.
I mean, a lot of people will say, "Whose line is it anyway?" The show,
right?
That's the most common thing that people have heard of when it comes to improv comedy.
Honestly, we're trying to move away from saying it because it does give an impression about what improv is supposed to be. Whereas improv is much broader than that. Mm-hmm. Whose Line Is It Anyway is actually one type of improv. There's two schools of improv called short form improv and long form improv.
Oh, I didn't even know that.
Yes.
That's cool.
What we did today is short form improv. Okay. Like Whose Line Is It Anyway?
Yeah, there's a specific structure, sometimes like a built in gimmick, if you will.
We play games, right? Okay. The shorter kind of games and things. And then long form is what you'll see a lot in like Los Angeles and Chicago. And we do it occasionally as well, which is more of a theatrical style with less assigned gimmicks and more discovery during scene work. And it goes for much longer. Like the scenes will be there won't be breaks in between scenes. They'll just kind of move into new things. And it can go for anywhere from 30 minutes to I've seen a show go for 2 hours one time. So.
Wow. I'm much less familiar with that form.
Most people are. Yeah.
How do you, because I know in the short form you're getting, you know, feedback from the or cues from the audience how does it work in long form? Do you?
Some will revisit the audience. It just depends on the structure. Like there's a form called the Armando Diaz where whoever's doing, they do monologues. So they always introduce themselves as Armando Diaz, the Armando. And they'll do a monologue and then we will do scenes based on that monologue and then we'll come back and do a monologue kind of inspired by the scene. So it's kind of a back and forth.
It's like a conversation between a monologist and the improvisers, essentially.
Oh, that sounds really fun.
But audiences still react in pretty much the same way. You will find occasionally that like long form can sometimes be more like audiences that are super engaged and interested in what's going on and not necessarily as laugh out loud funny.
Right.
It just depends. But I've also seen long form shows that are funnier than any short form show I've ever seen. And people were rolling in the aisles and, you know, wetting themselves.
Well, and the structure of long form can get away from like necessarily being a comedy show.
Right.
Quote. A good friend of ours, Nick Armstrong, has a group called Kind Strangers that does genre prov.
Yeah, they do improvised
Tennessee Williams.
An improvised Tennessee Williams.
Wow.
There's improvised Shakespeare groups. We're part of one. There's improvised rock operas. I mean, there's
Wait. Improvised Shakespeare. So how does that work? Do you speak in your, I mean, you're speaking
there's
in old English.
There's a couple of different ways to accomplish sounding Shakespearean, if you will.
There's actually a really easy cheat to sounding Shakespearean, and that's basically taking any phrase that you would normally say and making it and just saying the same thing, but
as elaborate and long as possible.
Explaining everything in the sentence. So if it's like my dog, I took my dog to the park, it would be like, I ventured forth upon the streets with my ground beast of fur and brownness to the field of public transport. Yeah.
Yes.
That's fantastic.
Like that.
I
and
love
it's
it.
The cheap way of being like, this is Shakespeare now.
And then rock opera, was that another one I
yeah,
heard?
Yeah, we know groups that do improvised musicals
entire
and rock
improvised
operas.
Musicals,
and
yeah.
How does that work?
Well, there's a show in Los Angeles called Opening Night the Musical, and their whole thing is that they get the title of a play or a musical that hasn't been made from the audience, and that this is the both opening and closing night of that performance, and they have a pianist who is able, because, you know, musicians, improv is very close to, like, music as
yeah,
well.
So right.
We're versed in a lot of, like, music styles, and he'll play
yeah.
it. And
yeah.
The singers obviously are talented singers and understand music and working with each other, so they just
And they've played
make
so
it up
long together.
There's wow. even pseudo-choreography.
Yeah, they'll do choreography in the back.
Oh, my gosh.
They're just like, oh, this is that kind of number.
They all just right. understand how each other work and, like, the structure of music and musicals. And
so, I mean, like, improv really, when I mean, coming back to the question, is – to me, improv, I mean, it's playing pretend on stage and being real and honest mm-hmm. with other people on stage for an indeterminate amount of time.
Yeah.
And just seeing
yeah, just reacting
it's discovery
honestly. Yeah.
is what
discovery.
It is. Yeah.
Yeah, if you do it right, it's a lot of discovery. So.
A lot of people also, you know, assume that improv is supposed to be funny because you commonly hear the word improv comedy.
Right.
They're attached to each other. We actually have a friend who said the worst thing that ever happened to improv was somebody put the word comedy after it.
Ah.
Only because while it does lend itself to being funny a lot of the time because mm-hmm. we're not planning anything and mm-hmm. silly things happen, mm-hmm. Some of the best improv I've ever seen was dramatic improv mm. where they were very real. And they're like, the audience was crying.
Yeah, just allow yourself to get to a very real and vulnerable place. And
because you still approach it the same way, is just being honest and in the moment with your partner on stage. And
that's amazing.
Yeah.
I have two questions. One, do you have a preference, either of you, long form, short form, or do you enjoy them both the
I
same?
I enjoy them both. They both have merits.
But yeah. I view them kind of like, they're kind of like two genres, right? It's like, I like science fiction movies, and I also like
rom-coms.
No, I don't. But and I also like action movies, right,
yeah.
or whatever. And while they may not be the same thing, I can enjoy mm-hmm. both of them.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, they're fulfilling in different ways.
So. Yeah, short form can be a lot of fun just because it's so zany and kind of madcap.
Yeah.
And you're kind of forced to do some things you probably would never naturally do on your own. Like if you're playing a game of accents and somebody tells you to now speak in an accent, a Hungarian accent, you're like, well, I would never have thought to do this in a scene, but I'm doing it now.
Here we go.
Sure hope this is kind of close.
Well, and then my other question is – in your Friday regular Friday shows, do they ever venture into the dramatic, or do you stick pretty hardcore comedy?
It has happened, but usually it's predominantly comedy.
Yeah, mm-hmm. It hasn't happened during our regular show for a while. It'll happen during like our Red Rocks Improv Festival,
right?
Where groups will come in, or we will have during one of our scenes something like that will happen. But yeah, our Friday night show is generally funny. All the time, just because, again, short form kind of lends itself more than long form to being stuck in the comedy realm.
Right.
Only because of, like, cool.
Yeah, how
but
it
I
is.
Think of,
I'm forcing you to now be a chair in a scene or something
right,
like that.
Right.
That's obviously not going to be super conducive to being dramatic.
Right, right.
But there was a group that came to our festival this last year called Debbie Downer.
Mm-hmm.
And the
oh,
focus,
wow.
the two guys that founded it both had lost parents within that same year. And so they use improv as kind of a form of catharsis. To,
not within that same year, but in a
yeah, when they
recently.
First, when they
yeah,
first
yeah.
formed it.
Yeah.
And so they used, I mean, they would, there was funny scenes, but it was also them kind of like addressing that. And then this year they had they invited Wendy Penrod to perform, in which she talked a lot about like her pregnancy difficulties that she's having. And it was just
wow.
really I mean, there's funny stuff, but there's also very beautiful, real heartfelt moments. So.
Yeah. Well, I want to ask you more about the festival and your classes a little bit later. One other thing on which I'm sure you get asked all the time is about preparation and rehearsing for improv. And so I know it's kind of a standard question, but I'm sure there are people that are curious about it. So it's improvisation. How do you prepare?
So we liken it to a sports team.
Okay.
So a sports team runs drills and they practice, but they can never know exactly what's going to happen in the game. But that doesn't mean they don't practice, right? Mm-hmm. They'll still run drills. They'll run plays if it's a football team or something like that. Figure out the motion so that they're getting used to it. It's like that in improv as well. So obviously we don't know what the show is going to be. Mm-hmm. That would take us a lot of work for us to plant people in the audience and write scripts out every single week.
Right.
Some people thought
we did that, and I was like, wow, they're giving us way too much credit.
Really? People actually asked that.
They thought every week we wrote and rehearsed and memorized a two-hour show.
Oh my gosh.
Because I don't know why you thought that was easier. But who's
got that kind of time?
You just become familiar with each other, like, styles, I guess. And, like, the moves they were going to make and, like, their structures that you learned kind of thing, and like what works best, what doesn't work good.
Yeah, so we'll just do scenes with each other, or we'll practice some of the games, that sort of thing, and see how it goes, and then talk about it afterwards and be like, hey, I think this choice is what led us down to this weird area that made it hard. So
yeah, to be like, I don't understand what you're trying to do with that move. You can be like, okay.
Yeah, you weren't very clear with that move, and so I took it this direction, and I could tell that threw you off slightly. So,
but knowing the people you improvise with well, like, that helps a lot, because you know what kind of, like, characters and styles and, you know.
So. And so is it a regular time that you get together, like,
in the
space?
Yeah, we have a weekly rehearsal that we get together and work on
in
it.
In your venue.
Yeah.
And then is it kind of serious, like, okay, we're rehearsing, or is it more just we're getting together and getting to know each other?
It depends on the week.
Both.
I mean, most of us have been performing with each other now
for years.
Well, yeah, for me, it literally has been 14 years with all of you guys. So,
But a lot of troops that are forming will actually, apart from the rehearsal, they'll have, like, mandated hangout times so they can get to know each other.
Really?
Because that's an important part of it.
And there's also people who coach in improv. So, like, a team will have a coach sometimes that will just be there to give them feedback and, like,
oh, cool,
and kind of help them develop what they're doing on stage.
And do you guys use a coach at all?
We have coaches that are in LA,
like,
so
they'll come in and
they
we
come
will
in
do workshops with them and stuff like that, because we're always trying to add new, like, tricks and tools to our craft and stuff like that. So.
Other than that, we also kind of rotate as people who will kind of just sit out and watch everybody else.
Oh, cool, right.
Give some feedback as well.
Like I said, most of us have at this point of the core group of Off the Cuff have been playing with each other and known each other for years.
Well, that was another question I had. It seemed in today's performance, I mean, I've seen several of you before and then maybe a couple of new faces.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
How do you break in a new member?
It's like
a hazing ritual.
Yeah, we strip them naked and then we cover them with tar and then we throw pillows at them. So this kind of goes to our classes, which I know we're going to talk about a little bit later. But all of our players that we've kind of come to have been people who have participated in our classes or workshops at some point or another. Because what we look for before we put somebody on stage is just, we like to see how they play with other people. And so if people ask us, how can I get to be a part of, performing on stage with Off the Cuff? That's the easiest.
Yeah. Come to the classes and then we see where you are from there. Right.
All right. So aspiring improv comedy people out there, that's how you heard it there. That's how to get involved.
And I mean, here's the thing also, and again, this kind of goes to our classes, even if you don't want to, do improv, that's totally fine. I totally get that it terrifies a lot of people. It can be a scary thing. Mm-hmm. But as Wendy said earlier today, I do believe that anybody can do improv and be good at it. But if you don't want to do any of that, you're the kind of person who's like, I'm not a performer. I don't want to. Mm-hmm. I don't want to go into that world because it's very lucrative. No, it's not. but improv I've found just in general is really helpful for everyday life.
That's the core rules, which we talked a little bit about the show earlier, was super beneficial for you as a person if you really embrace and implement them.
It makes people – honestly, it just makes people better in general. Like, some of the greatest people I know are all just improvisers, and that's not just on stage. That's off stage as well.
Yeah.
Because they have learned and adapted and taken in these tenets of always saying
they're positive,
yes,
and they're open and loving
always saying yes, or being like accepting
and adding on to it,
and adding on to what's going on, committing fully to it, leaving ego at the door, because judgment is the biggest killer of improv.
Judging yourself or judging other like improvisers,
and then respect in general,
Well, that's a perfect, because when we get back, I want to talk about the classes and the festival and get back to those four rules that I'm so fascinated about, which you kind of alluded to. But now it's time for another song. This song is called Bite the Hand by Julian Baker. And once again, this is KSUU Thunder 91.1.
You're too far away. I can't see you. The light is in my face. I can't touch you. I wouldn't if I could. I can't love you how you want me to. I can't love you how you want me to. I can't love you how you want me to.
Everyone, welcome back. This is KSUU Thunder 91.1, the Apex Hour, and we're in the studio with members of Off the Cuff Comedy Improvisation Group based right here in Cedar City. We've been talking about their shows, and we're going to get into some of the other things that they do, but their website is OTC and then comedy, all one word, .com, and you can check it out. And they have regular shows on Friday evenings at 10 p.m., a great date night thing to do.
It seems like that seems to be a very popular thing.
I mean, that's
awesome. We definitely
awesome.
See guys guys walking in with girls, girls walking in with girls, guys walking in with guys, all sorts of things.
People are definitely walking in.
People are definitely walking in.
That much we can confirm.
Well, one of the things I'd love to get into is some of the other things in addition to the weekly shows, which I didn't know a lot about what you do, but you guys offer a ton of classes.
Mm-hmm. We've been doing a class every, so we'll do a class, a 5-week class, then we'll take like 2 weeks break, and then we'll do another 5-week class.
Okay, so they're 5-week mm-hmm. commitments.
Yes, just one day of the week, though. It's right. Only Wednesdays from 5 to 7. So
it's not, always Wednesdays. Okay, great.
Yeah, so it's not like a huge, oh man, 5 weeks, and you have to be there every single day.
No, that's
for 4 hours at a time. No.
I mean, I think that that's a perfect time. It's like just a nice, you know, little block in there. 5 weeks is like a really nice kind of length, you know?
Yeah.
That's awesome.
And it ends with, so they have 5 weeks of the class, and then on the Friday following the last class, they get to do a show, a showcase show.
Oh.
Before our show on Friday. So they'll have their show at like 7 o'clock. In our theater, completely free for anybody to come and watch. They're encouraged to invite all of their family to come and everything, and they get to show off what they've learned.
And about what are the sizes of the classes?
We try to cap it off at around 12-ish.
A dozen.
Uh-huh. We've gone a little over that before if there's a whole lot of interest. It's just tough to go too far beyond that because then not everybody gets a lot of time to actually mm-hmm. play in the class, do the exercises.
And you're really getting into some great emotional building, personality building. You know, you're getting into some deep things, and I'd love to ask you some about it. Mm-hmm. We mentioned a little bit the confidence building class. That's mm-hmm. the one coming up.
January 30th. Yep. Mm-hmm. So a week from yesterday. So this Wednesday will be the first of the first week of the confidence building class being taught by one of the founders, TJ Penrod.
Ah.
The class focuses completely on finding where you can be comfortable on stage, how to kind of break out of your shell a mm-hmm. little bit and figure out what your voice is in improv.
Mm-hmm.
And then kind of just, you know, dip your toes into the world of improv.
And it sounds like it could even be a great class. I mean, even if somebody's not like, whoa, I really want to get into performing, but just kind of want to get more comfortable sort mm-hmm. of in your own skin, being out there, conversing, mm-hmm. talking, improvising, like you were saying we do in daily life.
Yeah, exactly.
I mean, seems like it could be a really great thing for that
A big aspect of improv that I really like is there's a saying that you are enough, right? Everyone is uniquely infinitely unique, and right, nobody has their life experiences and their views, so that makes who they are and what they have to say interesting because there's no other version of that.
Yeah, I love it.
So. We want to hear your voice because nobody else will ever be able to do your voice, so if you don't share it with us, we're never going to get to that.
We just try to help people find the courage to do that on stage.
And I could imagine that maybe some parents are listening and maybe they have a teenager who, you know, is just sort of feeling out their way and mm-hmm. that would it be something that would be appropriate for teenagers, high school students?
Think so.
Oh, yeah. We actually have a kid who's been coming to all of our classes since we started doing them who I'm not entirely sure what his age is now, but I know that when he started, he was only like 12,
yeah.
I think.
Wow.
We've taught all the way down to elementary school kids. Now, that's a specialized kind of workshop,
yeah.
obviously. But we can usually handle middle school through mm-hmm. high school in our regular classes.
Great.
But I think, it would be beneficial. Like, I know in high school, I was cripplingly shy.
Yeah.
I
can't believe that. Outgoing.
I have very, very, like, low self-esteem. So I really think if I would have had some of these things, I think I would have been.
I'm still an introvert.
Yeah.
Yeah. So.
It just sounds like a great thing for everyone, but for young people in particular, you mm-hmm. know, who might be dealing with either confidence or shyness, mm-hmm. you know, to get out there.
Even if you want to like become a better like public speaker,
yeah,
can be beneficial.
If you want to do better at like presentations in class,
yeah.
If you want to just be better at like job interviews and things, all of those areas I've noticed marked improvement for myself, mm-hmm. if not other people as well.
Just being comfortable in your own skin.
Yeah. Fantastic. So that's the confidence building one. And again, that's going to start next week. Is there still space available?
There is.
Yes.
Okay. So if you want to register for that class or are interested, go to our website, www.otccomedy.com. Go down to the classes section. You'll see where you can click to register for the class. It is $50 for the 5-week course plus a show.
That's a great price.
And you also get into shows free.
So while you're in the class, you get into all of our shows for free.
Fantastic.
Watching improv really helps you learn improv.
Yeah.
And then if you have any questions, like, for instance, you want to join, but you can't drop $50 immediately because I know that college students, for instance, I know.
Super rich.
I'm not even in college anymore, and I'm still like, oh, $50 in one go is tough for me.
Yeah.
So we do offer payment plans. If you just talk to us, we will set something up for you. You could pay like $10 a week if you want to, and by the time you're done, that's the $50.
You
can pay half up front, half later.
Yeah.
You can also
some work study things where you can.
Yeah. If you would like
do
to
do volunteer hours.
Ask us questions about possibly interning with Off the Cuff, because we offer those as well. You can email info@otccomedy.com and just introduce yourself and what you're looking for, and we'll get back to you almost immediately. Well, I mean,
when we can.
I can't say immediately, but we're usually really fast at getting back to people.
And that's great. So you have some intern possibilities available as well, it sounds like.
Yeah. So essentially what they would do is in exchange for taking the classes, they would just work at our shows. They would run concessions or run tickets, that sort of thing.
Perfect.
Yeah.
And so the confidence building one, you have like an improv 101 and games. You also have classes on relationships, emotion, and point of view.
Yes,
can
indeed.
You talk about those a little bit?
Okay, so here's the thing. Improv, there are so many schools of thought as to the best way to do improv.
Yeah.
There are some people who are very sure of their way and say that it is the right way to do improv. And then there's a more recent trend in improv. So that's kind of the older improvisers from the 80s who kind of are like...
Yeah, there's certain schools that teach a very specific structure, be it character-based or like scene-based.
And
or
teach it as the end-all, be-all of how you're supposed to do it. But in since 2000 and up, essentially, there's been this big movement of everybody just deciding, you know what, there's not one right way to do this, and everybody should kind of figure that out for themselves.
Yeah, just finding the best way for you.
Yeah, right? Taking classes, picking and choosing the things that you like from that class that work well for you, and then being like, oh, this other stuff is cool, but I'm not going to use it.
Just throwing it away. Yeah.
And so our theory at Off the Cuff, the thing that we like to focus on is relationships in scenes. And in addition to that, though, there's a lot of other elements that can go into it. And so we like to teach a lot of the different elements that can make your scene work more rich and more intricate and then allow for a greater chance of success. And so we have classes like emotions, because emotions is kind of what I like to call the cheat card of improv, which is if you don't know what you're doing in a scene, make a strong emotional choice about what just happened and see where that takes you.
Right.
Because it can help
have
you.
Have a feeling about something.
Right, so, right.
Or a feeling about someone.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Because that also adds relationships in there. Point of view is like, okay, so am I a higher status or am I a lower status?
Oh.
How do our characters relate to each other if we're starting this scene and you're all the way on the other side of the stage and I'm right here? Why are we like that?
A couple on a date that are like 5 feet apart says a lot about how they feel each other.
Right.
Feel about each other than like
people who are like a foot apart from each other.
Just I never thought like that. Of that in relation to the scenes. That's
well,
really cool.
Well, I mean, there's so many things like the temperature of the room, sounds in the room, right? Like there was this one show where there was a cricket that was trapped in the door, wouldn't shut up. That affects like everyone hears that and they're aware of that, right?
Yeah.
We saw a show in L.A. that it was at a theater that a nightclub had just opened up next door. And so,
so loud.
They were trying to deal with it because the music was so loud that it was hard to hear the shows. And these two guys who are amazing improvisers, their team is called Ranger Danger and the Danger Ranger. They made the best move possible, which was they decided to be bouncers at a nightclub for the entire show, essentially.
Oh, that's awesome.
And so they just had to be like, So what are you doing this weekend? Just shouting over the music and stuff.
But yeah, like your environment. Yeah, those things all factor in.
Yeah.
And I mean, you know, as much as we don't like talking about it as much, but politics can come into play as well. And
Right. One
of the fun things to do is you either play what your politics are, or what's even more fun is playing the opposite of what your politics
Right. Are,
because then you got satire happening.
Right,
and
right.
Good times.
So. Oh, cool.
Yeah.
And then you have an annual festival that
Yes. You
host here.
Yes, we do.
Tell us about that.
So that happens in September every year. It's usually around the 20th of September. I could actually probably get the actual date right now. Hold on one second.
And the name of it is?
The Red Rocks Improv Festival.
Red Rocks Improv Festival.
Coming up is our 10 year.
10 years.
Yep.
And you have a tab on your website for it, so you can find out more about that.
I think this year's is going to be the 19th through the 21st of September.
Mm-hmm.
And it's 10 years running. We have groups. We've had people come through our festival from L.A., San Diego, Chicago, Alaska,
New York,
Phoenix, Tucson, Pocatello, Salt Lake.
All over.
Wow.
Florida. We just open up submissions and people submit and they bring teams. And
I was curious about that. So that's how it happens. You open up submissions and people can apply to come.
There's a website called the Improv Network, which is where all of us improvisers go to link together and also to submit to festivals and put our stuff out there.
The Improv Network.
Yeah.
And then do you guys sit in a room and adjudicate who gets to come? How does that work?
Yeah. So what it used to be is that was the case where we would it was usually myself, TJ, and Wendy who would sit and be the adjudicators and pick and choose. Now we kind of pick and choose ones that we for sure want just based on knowing the people who submitted. And then we send all the rest of them to an outside committee of unbiased people.
Yeah, we'll watch and rate them. And then
they'll rate them and send back what they thought, and then we'll pick from that.
Oh, cool. The festival's a few days, and is it evening performances or all day long?
It's evening performances, usually starting at 8 o'clock, going all the way through midnight on each of the nights. Thursday's sometimes shorter just because not as many people can come on a Thursday. But and it's usually $7 each night for the entire night.
Wow, that's a steal.
If you only want to stay for a couple of hours, that's totally fine because you're going to see a lot of really great improv in that short time. If you want to go in for the long haul, you can absolutely stay from 8 until midnight.
Wow.
You can be as exhausted as everybody else is. And it's a lot of fun.
And what a great way to see improv from other places, too.
Oh, yeah. All sorts and different styles and different, you know.
We had puppet improv one year. Yeah, where they would do a mixture of sometimes they would have puppets and sometimes one of them would have a puppet and the other was just a regular person and they just improv the scene.
She, one of them was an actual puppeteer that's on Sesame Street right now.
My gosh.
So
she does one of the new puppets on Sesame Street.
That's amazing.
And then we've had the genre prov. We've had
this last year. We had an improvised Harry Potter. There's a group that came for a few years that would do improvised Twilight Zone episodes.
Yep. How interesting!
And then during the day, we do have usually some workshops that happen. Like people come down and teach different forms and stuff like that.
Oh, cool!
Yeah.
And this is going to be the 10th year. So this festival has been going on for 10 years.
Yep.
Yeah.
And again, if people want to check out more about it, they can look on the website. We want to make sure to plug that again. It's otccomedy.com. And you can find out about the regular Friday night shows. You can find out about the classes. And you can find out about the festival.
And you can buy tickets in advance if you want to.
That's perfect. Cool. Well, I have one other question. Well, one, I want, you know, I love these four rules. I think I've asked them like three times today. So there are four rules of improv. And actually, I think they're four rules of life in a way.
Yeah.
And what are those rules?
There's other stuff beyond it, but usually there's kind of guidelines.
This is our philosophy. This is off the cuff's philosophy, which is always yes and. You will hear that in almost any improv group.
Right.
Yes and is a big rule.
Keeps things going.
Yeah.
It makes things go
Instead
to the next
being
thing.
Like, yeah. You have a chicken on your head. No, I don't.
Yeah.
It kills everything.
Right? It's just about acceptance and adding on to it.
Yeah.
Right?
So it's not necessarily saying absolutely yes to everything, but it's about accepting what has been said and then building on it.
Beautiful in life as well.
Absolutely.
Yeah, it's like a tennis match. You can't play unless the person's hitting it back to you. And
I mean, you automatically win if nobody hits it back to you.
Yeah, well, you know. Boring. Okay.
So always yes and. Mm-hmm. Commit fully. So
commit fully.
Anything you're going to do, do it 110%.
I love that.
Nobody got to where they are. Nobody won an Academy Award and got up there and said, well, thank you. I gave it about 25%.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Michael Jordan never was like.
Yeah, nobody any acceptance speech was like, I really phoned that one in. Like, it's give it your best. Give it the play at the top of your intelligence.
Preach. I love that.
Leave your ego out the door is the third one. This one feeds into all of the other ones because you can't yes and you can't commit fully if your ego is in the way.
And most of the time when improv goes wrong, it's because of ego.
It's because either you're judging other people and their choices, or more importantly and more often, you're judging yourself.
Right.
Which holds you back.
Yeah. And then respect is the final one. Just respect each other, respect
the audience.
The audience, respect the craft, respect like where you're at.
You know? Respect the theater, respect. Yeah. Yep.
I just love those. I feel like they could be maxims for life for everyone.
Generally, like if I try to apply them to my life as much as possible.
I actually, so Wendy and TJ Penrod, I was the minister for their wedding when they got married. And I actually used those four as the rules of marriage.
That's amazing. Because I mean, because it works. It absolutely. Yeah. I mean, you know, that's fantastic. I love it. Well, I can't believe our time is almost up. I do have my favorite kind of last question that I ask everyone. And it's like sort of one of these just fun kind of how you're feeling type questions.
Perfect.
And the question is what's turning you on this week? And so I'll give you a second to think about it. It doesn't have to be, it could be anything. It could be a movie. It could be a TV show. It could be a book. It could be an album. We've had people say all of the above, but it's just a fun way for our listeners to get turned on to new things. So let me ask you, what is turning you on this week?
Do you got something, Rev? Because I mean, I do.
So right now, because I'm teaching English class, I got the opportunity to read for the first time. I hadn't read it yet. I Am Malala.
Oh.
Which is a fantastic book.
Okay.
Remind me the author again.
Malala. I can never pronounce her last name.
Okay.
She won the Nobel Peace Prize.
Right. Okay.
Couple years ago.
Yeah.
And she was the one who was shot in the head by the Taliban.
Yes, right.
And survived and now lives in England and is a big proponent and fighter for women's education and women's rights in the Middle East.
Right.
And it's a beautiful novel written from her perspective. She's got such a fun way of relating her experiences, and it's very natural and I can't recommend it enough.
Great. Thank you for that.
Yeah.
Man, I wish I'd gone first because mine is so much less.
Is yours going to be the team of the Guardians of the Galaxy?
There's a few new comic books that I'm a huge comic
book
enthusiast.
But that's the beauty of this. Yeah. I mean, you know, like if you asked me, it'd be like New York Housewives.
I'm also playing Smash Brothers right now, so that's cool.
But there's a few new comic series that I'm really digging. So.
Okay. What are those?
Young Justice and the new Guardians of the Galaxy series.
Okay.
Tell us who's on the new Guardians of the Galaxy team.
Oh, it's Star-Lord. Lord,
right.
Groot, Beta Ray Bill, nice. Cosmic Ghost Rider, Moondragon, and Phi LaVelle.
Well, nice. The names alone are well worth a look. So, okay, well, thank you so much. I mean, what a joy it was to have you. I feel like we could have kept talking for more and more. You guys are so good at keeping the conversation going and letting us know all the great things that you're doing. We'll remind our audiences that the Off the Cuff shows are every Friday night at 10 p.m. here in Cedar City. You can buy tickets ahead of time, or you can go and tweet and hope that you maybe are part of the social media.
Oh, yeah.
Wendy's social media extravaganza.
Dun, yeah, we give away a free show every week. Yeah,
that's fantastic. So, and you can find out everything about the shows, the classes, and the festival on their website, which is otccomedy.com. Thanks so much, guys, for being
in
the studio.
Thank you. It was wonderful. Yes.
Yay. Well, we'll sign off for this week. This is the Apex Hour. Thanks for listening. Thanks so much for listening to the Apex Hour here on KSUU Thunder 91.1. Come find us again next Thursday at 3 p.m. for more conversations with the visiting guests at Southern Utah University and new music to discover for your next playlist. And in the meantime, we would love to see you at our events on campus. To find out more, check out suu.edu/apex Until next week, this is Lynn Vartan saying goodbye from the Apex Hour here on Thunder 91.1.